All right, thanks. Good day. So thank you very much for coming. We really appreciate it. My PhD and I work with Hussein and I'm co-supervised by Professor Christoph Mena. The title of my talk today is Streamlined Technology-Driven Orchestration, Investigating the Impact of Organized Orchestration on Teaching. So I left out the subtitle there. But another point to note here is that this also happens to be the current working title of my thesis. It's a very long title, right? So I just wanted to mention that I'm ideally going to spend the bulk of my talk running you through some studies and experiments that we conducted and the results and evidence that we've managed to gather so far. Right. So there's a lot currently going on in the educational technology research area, especially when it comes to improving the quality of education, right? And if you really seriously think about it, there are essentially two schools of thoughts here, right? So on the one hand, you have that we normally come up with interventions that are ideally focused on learners, right? So think of the MOOCs of this world and the project, right? And on the other hand, you have researchers that are coming up with interventions that are focused more on the educators, right? I'm not really trying to come up with a philosophical argument here, but we are leaning more towards the second case. We are convinced that focusing more on educator is the way to go. There's an overwhelming number of research or evidence that currently exists that points to the fact that explicit support for educators is one of the most effective ways of improving the quality of education, right? So one of the ways in which you can actually support educators, especially when it comes to formal learning spaces, is with orchestration, right? So this is essentially the real-time management of classroom activities or learning activities, right? So think of the range of activities that that individual, right, there highlighted would end up doing within a single, session, lecture session, could be a class, right? But there are a couple of issues that are associated with orchestration. Number one, it is challenging. And as we've come to, it's multifaceted in nature. And in fact, there's an overwhelming number of research that has been conducted that points to the many strands of orchestration that make it challenging, right? But some of the most important challenges associated with orchestration is actually the timing constraints, right? So think of the range of activities that an educator would end up doing in a typical learning session. The fact that all that has to be done within a fixed period of time makes it even more challenging, right? And so as we've come to learn, orchestration is ad hoc. What we've done is we've looked at a couple of things to try and help us understand the full extent of the ad hoc nature of orchestration. So early on during the scoping and framing phase of this work, we conducted expert review sessions with 8 UCT teaching staff. We have a better sense of how these individuals actually ended up using technology or integrated technology within their teaching processes. We embedded ourselves in a number, or at least in some of the courses that were run with some of the individuals that we interviewed there. We specifically interacted with an individual who taught a first year mathematics course, and we were in a an introductory statistics course, summer course. Something else we're working towards, this hasn't yet been finalized, is we're actually analyzing the UCT archived lecture recordings, right? This will actually give us a comprehensive overview of the ad hoc nature of orchestration, at least with regards to UCT, right? So just to kind of situate this, the claim of my work is actually pretty simple and straightforward. What we're saying is that streamlined orchestration can be attained through the use of an orchestration workbench that will enable explicit organization of learning activities. And we suspect or we feel that this could potentially make educators more effective within the classroom environment. And we have 2 core research questions that are guiding the work that we're conducting. So, towards the end of last year, we conducted a comparative analysis. And the main objective of this work was ideally to try and compare we are calling organized orchestration through the use of an orchestration workbench and ad hoc orchestration. So what we did was we used portable apps to simulate the what the average educator would otherwise have to go through for them to orchestrate learning activities in an ad hoc manner. And then we came up with a prototype workbench user interface to simulate organized orchestration. So the main objective of this study was essentially to try and figure out the full extent of the effectiveness, the comparative nature of the effectiveness and user experience between organized orchestration and ad hoc orchestration. We initially set out to basically envision a sort of situation where the organized approach would be more effective in a more positive user. Of the specific factors that we're interested in measuring, we looked at task speed associated with how the people or the participants we worked with orchestrated the learning activities, the extent of how they perceived they were successful at orchestrating those activities, their comfort level, and the overall user experience. Right? Talk more about the specific measurement instruments that we used and the overall procedure, experimental procedure. So we worked with 29 participants from the Cape Peninsula University of Technology. So these were students in the Faculty of Social Sciences, so Department of General Education. And what we ideally set out to do is to, we identified the orchestration, the two orchestration techniques to be the independent variables that we'll be looking at. And then the dependent variables, so the things that we're measuring were the time on task. So the specific strands of the measurement instrument that we used Active 2, right? So we're specifically interested in trying to look at the final result of the attractive dimension means that would be associated to each of the two different orchestration techniques, right? And then we also identified potential control variables in the form of ISP levels. So this is the year of study of the different participants, their teaching experience. So this is important for us because the setup there is such that beginning second year, the students are actually exposed to real-life classroom teaching, so they go out to teach in practice. And then we also assess their computing experience. So what we did was we actually performed the overall experiment using random experimental blocks. And so what we'll do is we'll have each participant that would walk in randomly assigned to either one of the two orchestration techniques, right? So think of portable apps and the workbench UI here. Right, so participant one will come in and they'll initially be exposed to the workbench, taught to orchestrate a series of learning activities and then subsequently move to portable apps. And then participant number two comes in, starts with portable apps and transitions to the workbench approach. We're essentially trying to counterbalance the orchestration technique effect, right? So what we did was we actually had them orchestrate a learning scenario from an open source textbook by Siavula, a teacher guide. It was a grade 5 teacher guide textbook. It was really important for us because essentially the sequence is a series of steps that a teacher is expected to go through as they're teaching the lesson. Right? So in terms of the measurement instrument, what we did was after the 29 participants were exposed to the techniques, we had a questionnaire, right? We ideally went for or set for the comparison A-B approach with Attractive 2. And so obviously we had them fill out a questionnaire that was associated to approach one and approach number two. And then finally, after they were done with that, we basically debriefed them and compensated them with 40 rand. So in terms of the results, time on tasks, what we found on average was that overall, on average, so learners were able to orchestrate this range of activities 14.7% faster than when using a workbench than when using portable apps. I'll talk more about the validity of the results here towards the end of this stage of my talk. And then in terms of the overall results from the attractive tool questionnaire, what we did was we used standard attractive tool presentation graphs here, right? So if you look at the presentation portfolio here, it actually shows you the specific character region within which different approach lies, right? So even though they both lie within the neutral character region, you'll notice that the workbench approach really hitted somewhere near the desirable approach, right? You don't really have to understand attractive two. The only thing you need to know here is that top right is good, right? And then bottom left is bad, right? Positive, negative. And then in terms of the actual specific dimension mean results, what we found was that overall, the workbench scored highest for the pragmatic quality, the identity-strativeness dimensions, right? But portable apps actually scored higher for stimulation strand of the hedonic quality, right? We were able to actually further analyze these results by looking at the actual specific weight pairs that are associated with the with each of the four dimension means. Right? Again, I'll talk more about the validity of these results towards the end. So something else that we did, remember we identified a couple of things. We did two things. We counterbalanced, right, the experiment. And then we also took note of the control variables, right? So we're interested in trying to analyze associated results that were more aligned towards the effect of the counterbalancing and the demographic differences. What we found with regards to the counterbalancing is, for the times, right? We found that participants in group one, right? So these users that first of all started with workbench and then transitioned to portable apps approach, we found that they were actually able to orchestrate these linear activities 6% faster using Workbench, right? But if you look at the group two users, so those that started with portable apps and then transitioned to Workbench, the overall, so the difference between how fast they were able to orchestrate these learning activities using portable apps and Workbench was only 5%, right? So what we also observed was that there was a trend, at least associated with attractive two results with the counterbalance group. So there wasn't really that much of a difference between the overall result and the result that we got from groups one and two. A couple of obvious demographic results were actually noted, except for the fact that what was really interesting was that so what we expected was that students that were, you know, let's say in fourth year would be able to let's say orchestrate these learning activities faster than those in lower years. But funny enough, control variable associated with the ISP level, we found that actually able to orchestrate these learning activities faster than ISP 4, for instance, a bit old there, right? So overall, the findings, well, we noticed that obviously learning activities were actually able, on average, on the whole, the learning activities were orchestrated faster using an orchestration workbench. And then the perceived success was more pronounced with the workbench as opposed to portable apps approach. In terms of the user experience, so looking at the, ideally, you notice that I mentioned that the experience was actually measured by using, the two, it's actually supposed to be the two hedonic qualities, means, and then the attractiveness dimension. But what noticed in our findings was that, with exception of the stimulation hedonic quality, they were higher in the identity and the attractiveness dimension, right? So with regards to the validity of the result, we are well aware of the fact that there's actually no statistical significance associated to the results, and we have a pretty good idea as to why this is the case. It's actually mostly due to the fact that when we initially set out to go and conduct the experiment, we computed the minimum number of participants that would require for us to get statistically significant results. But we unfortunately only ended up working with 29 instead of the minimum 52 participants. And so the plan now is to replicate the study with the remaining number of participants. Right. At some point in 2014, towards the end of 2014, what we did was we conducted an experiment within an authentic educational setting. Right. It was actually a it was actually with a computer architecture course, so CSC 2002S. And the interesting thing about this course was that it was the first time that the educator was actually experimenting with a new learning model, right? So what the educator did basically was they flipped the classroom. Basically is to come up with a prototype that would be able to aid the educator orchestrate the three core learning activities classroom setting, right? So what they essentially did was, the core learning activities were actually in the form of quizzes that were performed in class, and then discussion. So the main aim of the study was ideally to assess the feasibility and potential impact of the proposed approach, right, in an authentic educational setting, right. So we set up to precisely figure out the extent towards which this approach would aid the orchestration of this particular setting and its potential impact on the learning experience of the learners, right? And so even though the main focus of the work is really to look at the teacher aspect of the entire ecosystem, we're wary of the fact that learners are actually an important aspect of the setting, and so we set out to actually figure out, you know, what sort of impact this sort of approach would have. Right? So we came up with a workbench UI to aid in the orchestration of the three core activities. And in terms of what exactly we did to evaluate this is after the 12 sessions, so the tool was actually used within the entire 12 sessions of the course. Took place over, I think, actually analyze the usage pattern of the different, the range of orchestration tools that the educator actually ended up using within this setting, right? We took advantage of UCT's lecture recording platform, OpenCast Matterhorn, and what we did was we actually, so what OpenCast Matterhorn does is it actually segments the different, so every time a lecturer switches context, it actually takes note of that, and so we're able to take advantage of that fact and try and determine the range of tools that were used and the frequency associated with those. Right. So I mentioned 12 sessions, but the ones that were actually recorded by OpenCast Matterhorn were 11 sessions. Right. And then in terms of the interaction with the educator, what we did was we actually held informal interview sessions with them to try and get a better sense of what their perceived views were like with regards to using the tool. And then we embedded ourselves within this setting, so we'd actually sit in the lecture sessions to try and, you know, observe what was going on in there, right? And then on the last day of class, what we did was we conducted a survey with the learners. So out of the 175 that actually subscribed to the course, we ended up working with, we recruited a total of 71 of them. And the objective here with the learner survey was to try and elicit their subjective views with regards to different features that the tool provided, right? So in terms of the analysis, what we found was that overall, I mean, you look at the table on the right here, it shows you your views of each of the different orchestration tools that were used by the educator within the 12, well, in this case, 11 sessions. And what we found was that on average, the tool was obviously used 6.7% of the time. And switching, so moving from one tool to the other, occurred on average 2 times for each session. So in terms of the analysis for the learner side that we conducted, what we found was that, at least based on the results that we got from the questionnaire, the learners felt that the tool actually helped organize the learning activities, right? And then the static sequencing feature that was utilized was actually found useful, were found desirable by the students. For instance, the timer feature, right? So what we found was that the tool actually helped in facilitating the neutral flow of activities, right? So as the educators transitioning from one activity to the next, right? And then what we also found was that, and this was really profound for us, the fact that the learners felt that the tool was impact neutral. And we were able to figure this out from the open-ended responses that we got from the learners. We had responses that were in the form, for instance, that you know, some of the learners were not able to notice that the educator was actually using this different orchestration tool, right? And so overall, we noted that the approach has the potential to facilitate you know, positive impact on the learning experience of learners. In terms of the future directions, so first on the list is we need to replicate the comparative analysis study experiment. That's really important for us. And unfortunately for us, we are at the mercy of the people we worked with before, because we need the same sample pool for us to be able to, I mean, for this to make sense. Otherwise, we'd have to work with an entirely new group of 52 participants, which really wouldn't make sense. It would be expensive for the most part. We're also working towards looking at guided. It's very important. Of the two experiments, some have actually measured orchestration load, and so we're actually thinking of taking advantage of this. We will be doing this with CSC 1010. Been here from last year, and so the plan is to actually. So it's something interesting about this course, right? So if you compare it to the other first year courses, the tutoring system is too regimented. So the tutors are expected to do specific tasks when they go to tutor the learners, right? So we're thinking of using our approach to help them in orchestrating all those different range of enactment of learning activities. What we've done so far is we've used our static sequencing, so we're trying to make it dynamic and try again to measure end-to-end orchestration load associated with the pre-session management and the actual orchestration that goes on. And then also, as mentioned before, trying to finalize a comprehensive analysis of the archived lecture recordings. We are certainly not going to analyze all the lectures that have been archived, but a select few. And then finally, we are working with two honor students to try and experiment with what we're calling reusable orchestration open education resources. Ideally, if we come up with this standard way of orchestrating learning activities, the next obvious step is to try and explore how, you know, different orchestration scenes or sequence chains can be shared amongst educators, right, easily. So these are some of the references associated with the talk. And I'll take questions if there are any. Okay.